One is clustering, which basically, in at least for my approach, doesn't mean to recognize altogether structures of the entire molecule, but more it's about recognizing atomic scale patterns that are the building blocks of complex mesoscale kind of systems. And then I will discuss about mapping high dimensional data in low dimension. And here the idea is that when you have something like a polypeptide described with all the atomic coordinates, you can often come up with a description in which you coarse grain somehow the conformation of the molecule into a smaller number of degrees of freedom, and you can do this automatically. And I will show you some, you know, some traditional and more modern ways of doing this. So I also want to stress that there is also, in principle, hands-on associated with this, but there was no time to actually make it in practice. So the set of handouts with the Leonard Jones cluster on the cover actually describe, guide you through this, handout. And if you have time and you want to try yourself, you can download all the files that are necessary to run it. So, okay, let's start by looking at the data from one of the kind of simulations that I run. So you run your simulation for a week, and then you end up with 5 terabytes of data. Each configuration of your system looks something like this. A load of numbers, and I don't know if you can understand what it is. I can't. So you really can't just stare at the data and infer some information about your system. And this is sort of interesting because it's sort of the opposite problem of typically what our experimental colleagues have. We have so much atomistic detail that we don't know what to do with it. So a first solution to this problem is making pretty pictures. Everyone loves pretty pictures. And that's actually something that really, I mean, I am very fond of pretty pictures because I think that they are a very powerful way of conveying deep understanding about a system in a way which really reaches your deep brain immediately. But still, as pretty as they can be, they don't tell you which of these structures is stable, which is not, and how you can transition from this structure to that one. So this is just a very superficial kind of form of representation of this high dimensional data. So what can we do when we have high dimensional data? So what we can do is try to abstract a little bit the problem and just think to each configuration of our molecule, of our phase, our system, as a vector in a high-dimensional space. So for instance, if I have a polypeptide, this is alanine 12, I can get a pretty good and comprehensive description of the state of the polypeptide just by looking at the vector of 24 dihedrals in the backbone. So I can associate each of these structures to a 24-dimensional vector with non-Euclidean topology because these are dihedrals. But this is the kind of abstract representation that I want to start from. And then what can you do with this set of configurations that are represented as high-dimensional vectors? You have the problem that you really can't make sense of anything which is in dimensionality greater than 3. So you need to do something to process this data that you can't understand into a form that you can understand. And I see this as a problem of mapping in a certain sense. So it's nice to make an example taking the surface of the Earth as the high dimensional system that we want to map. And one possibility is just to partition it in these joint regions. This is basically what clustering is about. You take your 24-dimensional space, and you say, OK, this region corresponds to state A, and this region corresponds to state B. And this basically gives you a list of the possible configurations that are homogeneous according to some criterion. And then you can interrogate your system. When you have a new configuration, you can ask yourself, to which cluster does this belong? And if you do something a little bit more sophisticated, you can also get information on how the clusters are connected to each other. I find personally more useful to have to attack the problem in terms of dimensionality reduction. So in terms of saying, I have the surface of the Earth, I map it in 2D. So this gives me the same kind of partitioning of space. I can also represent it in 2D. But in addition, I can also follow a trajectory of the system in the high dimensional space and map it to a trajectory on the map, which is something which is often very useful. So let's start from the first problem. So a problem of clustering. How do we cluster a set of data points? So how do we take a set of data points and we subdivide it in groups? So the most obvious way of doing so, and it's actually also what is the basis of many clustering algorithms, is to say, okay, I have some feature space that describes each of my configuration. This can be this 24-dimensional vector, for instance. I compute the probability with which I observe each of the possible conformations in this 24-dimensional space. I get a certain probability distribution, and then I partition it, saying that each maximum in the distribution is characterizes a cluster, and all, let's say, the attractor basin of that maximum has to be associated with that cluster. And then if you want to do something which is a little bit more sophisticated, you can also then represent each cluster with a Gaussian. This is a Gaussian mixture model. And then when you do this, you have, it's very nice because you have a probabilistic approach, for instance, to say whether you belong, whether new configuration belongs to this cluster or to that cluster. So actually, this is something which I think it's very important, because if you speak with your chemist's colleague, they talk all the time about chemical intuition. And in my opinion, chemical intuition is just a name for our ability to recognize patterns. So, you know, if you don't need to know about electronic structure to recognize the fact that within organic chemistry, you find all the time, you know, tetrahedral environments or planar trigonal environments or linear environments. Electronic structure allows you to rationalize this observation, but at the lowest level, chemical intuition is just recognizing that you have a small array of building blocks combining which you can build all of the organic chemistry. And what is nice about having atomistic simulations is that we have a lot of data about what are the possible arrangements of atoms. And since simulations have become relatively reliable these days, we can really use these to build a definition of chemical patterns, which is not based on our whim, on our say, oh yeah, this is a hydrogen bond or this is a sp3 carbon, but it comes out automatically from the simulation. So how can we do this? So the idea is really to follow through with this concept of constructing a probability distribution in feature space and subdividing it into its modes. So let's say that we have a system and that we have a chemical environment that we can describe based on two distances. So we run a long simulation and then we accumulate data points that say for this environment when you have a certain value or of the two distances. And then we build a probability distribution. We can do this on a sparse grid using a kernel density estimation. Basically, the point is that we build a probability distribution of how often we observe every pair of distances. And then we can cluster these with an algorithm that is called min-max. And the idea is that you start from each point of the distribution and you jump onto the nearest point with higher probability. So you always walk uphill. and you stop when the jump would bring you farther away than a certain threshold. You see, if I didn't put a threshold, no matter from which point I start, I would end up on the point of maximum probability, because I always walk up, and I walk up onto the closest point. So if I didn't stop, I will always end up at the point with maximum probability in my distribution. But since I introduced this threshold, I do stop, and depending on the point where I start, I will stop in a different position. So each of these are local maxima in the distribution, and they partition the configuration space in disjoint clusters. So once I have done this, I have recognized that in this system I have three different patterns. And in order to recognize them in new simulations, what I can do is build a Gaussian mixture model. So I associate a Gaussian to each of these clusters. And then I can use the posterior probabilities of this Gaussian mixture model. This is basically just, so I have several Gaussians. I take, I sit here and I take the value of this Gaussian divided by the sum of all the other Gaussians. So I get something that transitions smoothly from one, where I am part of this cluster, to zero when I move on to another cluster. So how can we use this? Let's consider the hydrogen bond, for instance. Yes? No, that's exactly the point. So generally, in a Gaussian mixture model, you need to guess the number of clusters, and also you don't know where you end up. You might end up, you start from three clusters, and since it's an iterative optimization, you might end up with two Gaussians associated with this cluster and one Gaussian here. You don't really know. So the idea is that here we do a two-step procedure. First, we do this non-parametric clustering procedure. So here, you just, from each point on the grid, you start climbing. And at the end, it tells you how many local maxima you have. And afterwards, we do this Gaussian mixture model, but it's not really a Gaussian mixture model in the proper sense. So we fix the centers to be on the maximum of the distribution of each cluster, and we only optimize the covariance. So the number of clusters is given by the non-parametric clustering. So basically, we use the Gaussian mixture model because it gives you these probabilistic fingerprints, which are very nice. But we do a first non-parametric clustering step so that we don't have this kind of problems of how many clusters do I have and how I initialize the Gaussians. So let's speak about the hydrogen bond. So hydrogen bond, I mean, there is no way to underestimate how important it is. I mean, water, yesterday we spoke a lot about water, but also polypeptides, I mean, DNA. I mean, really, it's probably the single most important thing for life as we know it. And chemists have really gone crazy with the hydrogen bond. So in 2005, there was a conference in Italy. It was called the Hydrogen Bond Task Force, 2005. And they discussed for 3 weeks about how you define the hydrogen bond. And in fact, if you look even from a computational point of view, there are dozens of ways of recognizing if you have a hydrogen bond or not based on different thresholds, on distances, angles, energy estimations. But from, I mean, if you stick with a purely structural definition, all the information you need is within these three distances, because a hydrogen bond is made up by a donor, an acceptor, and a hydrogen. So with three distances, you fully determine the geometry. And the problem is how to determine a region in the space defined by these distances that you tag to be a hydrogen bond. So for historical reasons, and also because it looks nicer, we use actually a combination of distances. But the algorithm really works just the same, even if you work directly with the distances. So we have decided basically what is the abstract feature space, so how we want to describe something that could be a hydrogen bond. But we still don't know what is a hydrogen bond. And we learn this by analyzing a simulation. So we take snapshots of a simulation, let's say of ice or liquid water or whatever. And then I'm really masochistic, and so I say, I forget the fact that I have water molecules. Because, you know, we might have defects, we might have charge fluctuations. So I just have hydrogens and oxygens. And then I look at all the possible groups of oxygen, oxygen, hydrogen. And the game here is finding out how to recognize that this is a hydrogen bond and this is not. So what I do is I build a probability distribution for these groups of three distances, and it looks like this. So here you have two symmetric lobes, because since I am not saying what is a water molecule, basically, if I sit on an oxygen, I could regard it either as a donor or as an acceptor, so I have two symmetric lobes. And then you can cluster these, and you find that, we have a cutoff on the distance here, but within this cutoff, there are four clusters, one, two, three, and a very weak one behind here that you probably don't even see. But the point is that this cluster is precisely in the range of distances that everyone always recognizes as the hydrogen bond. And so this is the cluster that we can call a hydrogen bond. But the nice thing is that with this procedure, now we have a probabilistic way to assign whether any point in configuration space is a hydrogen bond or not. And if you compare it with the you can build a three-dimensional. Yesterday I discussed these radial distribution functions. This is the same thing, but in 3D. So here I'm sitting on a water molecule and asking myself, where are oxygen atoms relative to me? So since I'm hydrogen bonded, I will probably have one there and one there. And since I'm also receiving hydrogen bonds, I will also have two oxygens on my back. And then basically what you want is that this region in feature space is recognized as a hydrogen bond. And here you can see a cut along this plane. And you can see that, so this green wedge would be a traditional definition of a hydrogen bond that, of course, I mean, people have not been stupid for the past 20 years. This is a very reasonable definition of a hydrogen bond. It encircles the region of maximum probability. But you see, this is the ISO contour of probability 0.5 based on this automatic definition, and it really follows very nicely the region in feature space that corresponds to what one would call a hydrogen bond. But the nice thing here is that if you change the boundary conditions, if you change your the model of water, you change the thermodynamic state point, or you switch on quantum effects, the distribution of distances changes. And if you trust your simulation, you should also change your definition of the hydrogen bond. And this happens automatically. So for instance, this is the probability distribution that you get when you switch on quantum effects. You see that compared to this, everything is fatter because I have quantum fluctuations in all directions, as we have seen yesterday. And now you have your new updated definition of a hydrogen bond. And then you can use this to do whatever you like. So you can recognize defects or look at hydrogen bonding in different systems. So you can, if you look at a small polypeptide in water, and you look at the hydrogen bond which is formed between the water and the oxygen of the protein, you have a completely, it's not symmetric anymore because this oxygen cannot donate. So it's asymmetric, and your definition of the hydrogen bond will adapt naturally to this new situation. Or same if you do look at the nitrogen donating to water, different distribution, different definition. And it all falls out automatically from your simulation itself. You can also do this if you work with polypeptides. You very often work with dihedrals. In a polypeptide, you are not only interested in hydrogen bonds per se, but you are interested in how the hydrogen bonds play around with the covalent backbone of the polypeptide. So I suppose that you have heard at least once in your life about alpha helices and beta sheets. So basically, when you have a polypeptide, it forms this three-dimensional structure. And every protein has a different three-dimensional structure, but you can recognize these patterns that appear over and over. And for instance, you have alpha helices in which you have a characteristic hydrogen bond pattern between residues that are, I think, four apart, but I'm not sure it's four. And beta sheets in which you have these flat layers with straight up strands of polypeptides. Now, in order to form these structures, the backbone has to take a particular shape. So there is a correlation between the secondary structure and the dihedrals of the backbone. And this has been recognized long, 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 long time ago. This is called the Ramachandran plot. And basically, someone looked at actually experimental crystallography data on which angles were found in polypeptides. You have these backbone angles, and noticed that basically only a few values seem to be allowed. And also you seem to have some clusters that can be assigned to different secondary structure patterns. So what happens if we take the whole of the protein data bank, look at the dihedrals, and we feed them to this probabilistic analysis approach? Well, it recognizes precisely that there are all of these patterns. And the nice aspect here is that since this analysis is automatic, you can extend it, for instance, to consider more dihedrals to get a more precise description. So for instance, here these two states are not very well separated from each other, but if you include a third dihedral in the description, now these two states are perfectly well described. So this is still work in progress, but the idea here is that using this automatic approach, you can really recognize even complex patterns in the condensed phase. So let's try now to move on and move up. So this far I was discussing how we can recognize automatically the building blocks of complex structures. But what about the complex structure as a whole? So if I'm not interested in recognizing the structure of a small segment of a polypeptide, but I want to tell you if as a whole the polypeptide is folded or denaturated, how do I do that? I mean, it's all of these clustering techniques lose steam very quickly when you move up to very large dimension. So we need to do something else. And if you have worked on simulations of complex systems, you often end up with this concept of free energy and of collective variables. And this is, for those of you who have never heard of this before, the idea is that you want to describe your big protein with just one or two numbers that tell you whether it's folded, it's not folded, or it's in a pathologically misfolded state, for instance. But finding these, these variables have to be functions somehow of the large number of coordinates that compose the polypeptide, and finding the relation between the high dimensional description and the low dimensional description is far from trivial. So typically, you go on a trial and error procedure. If you have been working on this for a long time, you have sort of a intuitive feeling of what it will work and what will not work. But it's a very, it's sort of a black magic procedure. So it would be much nicer if you could make this in a fully automated manner. And I will show you how you can do this. And this is not only good to gain an understanding of your system, but as we will see, it's also important because it allows you to reach longer time scales in your simulation. But I will get back to that later on. So yeah, let's start from that aspect. So let's start from the problem that when you have a complex system that can exist in multiple metastable states, I mean, this is not a complex system, but it can exist in a trans or a cis form. And the problem is that there is a free energy barrier for going from one state to the other. So if you are doing your simulation at a reasonable temperature where both structures are stable, what will happen is that for a very long time, your system will be just will be just oscillating back and forth. Wait a second. Will be just oscillating back and forth, doing nothing basically. And then after a long waiting time where you see not, yes. Of topology,
yeah.
You mean of the fact that it's like a rotation of the
yeah,
dihedral? Well, it depends on the system you have. I mean, in general, there can be some regularities, but in general, depending on the details, but even on I don't know the pH of your buffer solution, the height of the barrier can be different, and therefore the time it takes to make it will change. There are no general rules. So the more stable the two states, very often the harder it is to go from one to the other. But there is no really general rule. The general problem is the fact that you are in a situation in which you need to use a small time step to integrate your equations of motion because, well, partially because you have to follow the motion of individual atoms, but also partially because once the transition starts, it's typically very fast. And then you have a very long waiting time where nothing interesting happens, and then it basically becomes impossible to run your simulation. So, how can we attack this problem? Well, a first concept that I need to introduce to you is that of a free energy. So a free energy in the language of atomistic simulations is not precisely, even though, I mean, it's clearly related to, but is not precisely a macroscopic thermodynamic quantity that tells you in which direction a macroscopic reaction will go, but or how much work you can extract by pulling a piston. What we really talk about when we speak of free energies is a quantity that is related to the probability of observing one state over another. So it's basically given a variable that can tag the different states of the system. You build a histogram of how often you observe each state, and then you take minus kbt, the logarithm of it. So you, if you want to write it in a formal manner, you have your Boltzmann probability distribution, you have a delta function that selects target values of this order parameter, which could be, let's say, the dihedral angle in this case, but could be, I don't know, the distance between these two atoms or whatever. And you integrate it over the whole of phase space. Oh, here there is a logarithm missing, sorry. So there should be a logarithm here, kbt log of the integral, apologies. And then, I mean, why we introduce it in this way? Well, because it's basically the equivalent of a potential in collective variable space. So just as in coordinate space, the probability distribution is given by e to the minus beta v, in free energy space, the probability distribution is e to the minus beta f of s. Okay? So having introduced this, then the next step is recognizing that what is hindering the transition between the two states is the presence of a free energy barrier in it. Because it means now that if I have a free energy barrier, it means that it's very unlikely that I end up on the top of the mountain. And so I will have to wait a lot of time before I actually get there, very hand-wavingly. But if we could remove the mountain, if we could make it flat, now I could go back and forth very easily, and I could explore the transition very, very effectively. So the idea is that if you add an additional bias to your simulation, so if you modify the physical potential of your system by adding a bias that depends on the collective variable, you are just shifting the free energy. So you can see that this goes through. So if you do this, so if you add a bias that is a function of S, since the delta function selects just this value of s, this actually falls out of the integral. And so the free energy in the presence of the bias is just the free energy without the bias plus the bias. So this means that you can actually control and modify the probability with which you observe transitions just by adding a bias potential that is minus the barrier. Fantastic, right? So we have a way to remove mountains just by adding a valley potential. So what's the and then you can actually rebuild the beautiful thing of this is that you can still obtain any average in the absence of the bias just by computing your average, including a weighting factor. This is basically, you see, this is e to the plus beta the bias. So where the bias is high, this factor is high, and when the factor is low, this factor is small. So this means that we have made this flat, okay, but we have added a large bias here. So when we are in this region, this factor will be very large, and so we will give much more statistical weight to these points than to the points at the barrier, which have been made very likely by the addition of this bias potential, but they should be very unlikely in a real simulation in the absence of the bias. So with this factor, you can reconstruct the probability distribution that you would have had without the bias, even when you have the bias. Now, the problem is that, of course, if you knew what was the height of the mountain, your problem would have been already solved. So the question is, how do you get what's the shape of the bias that you need to add? So the idea here is to do this on the fly, okay? So the idea is to add this bias, to build this bias as the simulation goes, with the idea that if you stay long in a certain region of your configuration space, it means that you have a low free energy and you should go away from there. So let's say that you have a system that can exist in these two states, and there is a barrier in between. And if you run your simulation without any bias, it would be very boring. So it would be going back and forth forever. So after a while, you say, well, OK, I had enough of this. So you say, well, let's add a repulsive bias. So I add a Gaussian hill, which is centered in the position where I am. And now that there is this bias potential, I am pushed away. And then I keep adding hills. In the end, I will fill up the valley, reach the top of the mountain, and fall down on the other side. And if I keep going, I will basically fill up everything. And then I can go back and forth easily without any barrier. Now, let's go back. I mean, this was sort of an aside to explain you how you need the collective variables to accelerate sampling and go over free energy barrier and observe activated events. But now let's go back to the problem of dimensionality reduction, because in order to find this low dimensional collective variable, you need to do a dimensionality reduction. So you could do this manually based on your intuition and your experience, but it's really would be really, really nice to do this automatically. So how can we do this? So as I said, we can abstract the problem by saying that we have each configuration associated with one vector in a high dimensional space. Now, please stretch your imagination and think that each of these is a point in a 24-dimensional space, okay? And what we can do is compute what's the similarity or dissimilarity between these configurations. This could be just the Euclidean distance between these vectors. And then we have a matrix that tells us how similar is each of these reference states to each other of the reference states. And then we can play this game. So you all come here, and we start moving around you know, little cocktail flags on the desk, trying to make sure that the distance between the cocktail flags on the desk match the similarity computed in the high-dimensional space. If you do this, if you succeed, now you have a two-dimensional representation of your problem that preserves the distance relations between the high-dimensional configurations. And then, once you have done this discrete map, so once you have a set of reference states and their low-dimensional representation that preserves the important properties between them, you can take any other configuration and, using these points as reference, find where you should represent it in 2D. So this is a little bit like a GPS navigation. You are, you know, your GPS works by measuring the distance with the satellites. The GPS system knows where the satellites are relative to the surface of the Earth, and then they can find what's your position. So in a similar way, once you have found the position of your satellite configurations on the desk, you can find the position of any other point. Now, clearly, this is a very nice idea, but it only really works if I guess that many of you are pretty much mathematically oriented, so this only works if your high-dimensional points happen to lie in a linear subspace of the high-dimensional space. Otherwise, you can't match the Euclidean distances, at least exactly. So these will have to be approximated, and we will see how you can go beyond these, I mean, how you can relax these constraints. But now let me introduce you perhaps the simplest approach to make this operation in practice. So this is called principal component analysis, and the idea is that you have your data points, okay? So these are vectors in D dimensions. So now in principal component analysis, we are really assuming that our vectors are basically part of a Hilbert space, because you need a scalar product basically to do principal component analysis. But I mean, this could be just points in Rn. So this can just be vectors in Rn, and you define the matrix X where basically these vectors are, I mean, the components of these vectors are the columns, and the vectors are the rows. And then you can build something which is, I mean, letting alone how this is done, you basically build the covariance matrix of these vectors. And now the covariance matrix of this data set tells you what's the important direction. So the important direction is the direction over which you have a largest spread of your points. So after you have found the covariance matrix, you can do a singular value decomposition. So you basically find the largest eigenvalues of the covariance matrix. And you can select a linear subspace that contains as much as possible variance of your data set. Okay, so in this case, for instance, I could say, okay, I want to project this down to 1D. Well, after I do a singular value decomposition, I pick that this is the eigen state with the largest variance, and then I project all the points onto this direction, and I find this one-dimensional representation of this two-dimensional data set. So this is how, in practice, you can find a linear projector that contains as much as possible information on the variability within your data set. And then, actually, you can generalize this idea. I don't really want you to get too much into the details of this, but the idea is that you can draw a connection between the principal component analysis that you see is an operation that is based on the possibility of having a scalar product. So you really need, you must be working in a Euclidean space, basically, to be able to do principal component analysis. You can put it in relation to multidimensional scaling, which instead is a problem in which you have a matrix of distances, and you compute distances between your low-dimensional representation, and you try to minimize this objective function. So you see, what I'm trying to do here is I take the matrix of distances in high dimension, And I try to minimize the discrepancy between the low dimensional distances and the high dimensional distances. So you can show that if this is a Euclidean distance and you're assuming that the low dimensional points are linear projections of the high dimensional points, you can actually show that this problem is equivalent to the principal component analysis. But the advantage is that you can formally do this set of operations even if the distances are not Euclidean distances, and this will become important later. So let me give you an example, okay? So this is actually an actual example that people in the dimensionality reduction community use. So some botanist has gone around and measure some morphological characteristics of flowers of these three species of iris. And they measure basically the length and the width of the petals, the colorful things, and the sepals, which are the green things that hold the flower together. And botanically, they know that there are three species of iris. So they have this four-dimensional data set. They have something like 150 flowers. And they want to see if they can recognize the presence of three species based on an analysis of this four-dimensional data set. And if you run a principal component analysis, you do find that there are three groups of points that correspond to the three species. You can do, so here, I don't know if it's clear to you, but if you run principal component analysis, you get this representation. If you run multidimensional scaling, you get this, which is actually just the mirror image of this. Okay? And the reason why you get the mirror image is that in MDS, you work based on distances. So your result is invariant under rotations. So you can always get, it doesn't make any difference if you get this or that, but I ran the algorithm and I got this. But it's really the same picture. And you can do this iterative minimization, which doesn't change things much in here. And so what you can see is that there is some clear clustering, but that these two species are very close to each other. But if you go back and look at the flowers, this is really weird and different. And these two, I wouldn't be able to distinguish the two personally. So it's actually working pretty well. So the problem is that if you have something which is highly nonlinear, so for instance, this is another typical data set that is used in this community. It's called the Swiss roll, because apparently, I don't know, I live in Switzerland, and I never stumbled upon a Swiss cake which has this shape, but apparently there is a typical Swiss cake which is like a roll. You have this data set, you could imagine unfolding it and finding a two-dimensional representation in which you use this as one of the coordinates and the position along the spiral as the second coordinate. So in a certain sense, the local dimensionality of this data set is true, but is embedded in a three-dimensional space. And if you try to run principal component analysis, which is a linear projection, you just basically see the roll from the side, okay? So you are not able to unroll it because this is just a linear projection. So what we need is something that doesn't only work where the points are perhaps a little bit noisy, but really lie in a two-dimensional manifold, but we need something that works when points lie on a curved manifold, which is only locally linear. So we need something that when the points are locally part of a 2D subspace, then can open this up and show it nicely in 2D. So a load of techniques have been developed for doing this, and this really comes mostly from the image recognition and handwriting recognition community. And one of these techniques is called IsoMap, and this really relies on the fact that in multi-dimensional scaling, you can use any distance that you like. So for this technique, it's really important that you can generalize principal component analysis to work even with a distance which is not induced by a scalar product. So you have your Swiss roll data set. So what you can try to do is to measure distances between points, not using Euclidean distances, but by using geodesic distances. So what you do is you connect each point to its neighbors, and then if I need to go from this point to that point, I don't take the Euclidean path, but I follow the manifold from neighbor to neighbor, and now I estimate the distance between these two points as the geodesic distance, so as the sum of the distances between the neighbors. If you use this matrix to run your multidimensional scaling algorithm, everything opens up nicely. And the main problem, as we will see, is the fact that this is extremely sensitive to noise. So if by chance you mistakenly detect a point of the next manifold, I mean on the next fold of the roll as one of your neighbors, you can take shortcuts along the geodesic path that completely mess up your distance matrix, and you will see this, it really destroys completely the projection. So if you take the Swiss roll data set, you run isomap, perfect. So this is automatic representation of this data obtained by using geodesic distances. However, if you start adding some noise to the points, at a certain point, you fail catastrophically. So you see, you really, for moderate levels of noise, nothing happens. But as soon as you detect, here there is just one point which is off, and you see it has already sort of folded back an entire edge. And as soon as you have a couple of points that cut through, it's a total mess. So this is a problem, because when you run atomistic simulations, and this is really a key understanding, thermal noise is something you can't live without. It's actually a physical feature of your system, and you can't ignore it. You can't say, oh, yeah, I filter out noise a little bit, I smooth things up. No, I mean, thermal fluctuations are physics, and you have to cope with them at the design stage of your algorithm. Since I want to sort of give you a general introduction, I also want to discuss another possible standard algorithm for nonlinear dimensionality reduction. This is called the locally linear embedding, and this really relies on the concept that your data set is locally linear and only globally curved. So the way it works is, again, and this is its weakness, actually, it's based on a notion of locality. So you need to be able to define environments of a point. So you, for instance, you take this point, you take the few points that are closest to it, and then you in high dimension, you try to find the weights that, given the first nearest neighbors, represent the point as a weighted sum of its neighbors. Okay, so you see, this is the real point, and I try to write it as a weighted sum of the coordinates of its neighbors, and I optimize the weights until I get the weighted sum to be as close as possible to the real point. So this is stage one. So you do this for each point. So you write each point as a weighted sum of its neighbors. And then you go in shoe dimension, or I mean in low dimension, and you keep the weights fixed, and you optimize the positions in such a way that each point is self-consistently as close as possible to the weighted sum of its neighbors. So basically, in high dimension, you determine the weights with the points known. In the low dimension, you determine the points with the weights known. And you can map actually this problem onto an eigenvalue problem. And the problem with this is that it's not an eigenvalue problem in which it's very clear what are the good eigenvalues. So for instance, if you do locally linear embedding and you take the two largest eigenvalues for the Swiss roll, it doesn't look very nice. However, if you take 3 and 4, it works very well. And it's sort of resilient to noise, but the problem is that, for instance, I increase the noise, total mess, but if I go to 7 and 8, it looks fine. So the problem with this algorithm is really that you don't know what are the good eigenvalues, and I find this a little bit displeasing, and also, this is also very sensitive to noise. So the problem really is that we had started thinking that we could just borrow ideas from a different community, but we have perhaps to go back and look at what's the problem we are dealing with, because we are not dealing with data sets that look like flat, curved, mathematically precise surfaces. We deal with a data set in which noise is one of the main ingredients. So our data set really looks more something like this. So we have locally stable structures, thermal fluctuations in all directions, and then we have transitions between these locally stable structures. So how can we work out an algorithm that can be resistant to a system like this? I mean, so first of all, let me convince you that this is really the case, if you're not convinced. So if you look at something like alanine dipeptide, how does the free energy landscape looks like? Well, I have, as a function of these two dihedrals, I have these locally stable states. I will have distributions, which are like two-dimensional Gaussians around these states. And then I have a network of transition states to go around them. And if I look at alanine 12, and I look at any pair of dihedrals, it always looks like that. So this is really the way, this is the kind of data set that we have to work with, and we need a technique that is designed to cope with noise. And this is particularly, this is actually particularly problematic, because when you go up in dimensionality, noise starts to behave in a very non-intuitive way. This is something that is sometimes referred to as the curse of dimensionality. And it's in simple words, it's telling you that it's that distances become very non-informative when you go in high dimension. And you can see why by doing, I mean, this is something that you can do on a piece of paper, it's very simple. So consider a Gaussian distribution in one dimension, okay? You take two random samples from this Gaussian and you ask yourself, what's the probability distribution of the distance? I mean, how likely, so let's say that I have a Gaussian with variance one, what will be the most probable distance if I take two points at random? Any guess? So what, if I have a Gaussian of variance one, I take two points at random, and I ask myself, what's the most likely distance between them? Yeah, it's zero. Fine. Now, I go in 3D. Actually, now the probability of having a distance of zero has become zero. And this is just because of the volume element in phase space when I integrate out with the distance. But the problem is that as you go up in dimensionality, you get a distribution in which even if two points are part of the same multidimensional Gaussian, I have no guarantee that they will be close to each other. Actually, it would be extremely unlikely that I will take two points from the same Gaussian and they will be close to each other. So the notion of distance becomes very shaky when you go to high dimension. So assigning, using distances straight away to assign, to determine proximity is something which is very delicate when you go up in dimensionality. And the problem is that if you were trying to apply one of these distance matching techniques, it would be a disaster, because let's say that you want to represent 24 dimensions in three dimensions, and you want to reproduce the distances. You have your 24-dimensional Gaussian. You would like it to be represented by a three-dimensional Gaussian, probably. And there is no way you will ever manage to match the distances between 24 and three dimensions. So distances are not really something we should work with. So the idea is that we don't actually need, it's not really necessary to preserve the distances. So it's not like we need to get a very precise satellite picture with all the distances nicely preserved, green grass, the fields, the lake. And we don't even need something like this where we sketch a little bit, but we still work trying to match the distances. This is all you need if you come and visit me at EPFL. You know where you can get a beer, you know where you can get a coffee, where you can swim in the lake, which is not as nice as swimming in the sea, but it's decent, and how you go to town if you want to have a little bit more fun. So the point is, how would we encode on a computer this concept that we don't need to represent distances, but we can just leave with a hand-sketched map of the feature space of my protein. So let me give you a very simple example, just going from 2 to 1D. Let's say that I have this, that these points represent a chemical reaction. So here I have thermal fluctuations in the reactants, a transition, and chemical and thermal fluctuations in the products. Now, I think you will all agree that this is a fantastic one-dimensional representation of that data set. However, if I look at distances between points, I do have points that are pretty far away from each other in the reactant basin, and they end up projected on top of each other. So if I was trying to do something like principal component analysis or multidimensional scaling, there will be a tendency to blow up the basins because there are very large distances between them. And this would risk losing the resolution that allows me to distinguish reactants and products in the low-dimensional space. So what can we do? Well, what we can do is relax our requirement, because we really don't care that we have distances preserved within the reactants or within the product basins. All that we care about is if something is close in high dimension, it should stay close also in the projection. And if something is far relative to a threshold distance, it should stay far in high dimension. So the idea is that we move from matching distances to matching proximity. Okay, so we define a characteristic threshold which is associated with the scale of thermal fluctuations, and everything that is closer together than thermal fluctuations, I really don't care as long as it stays close together. And everything which is further apart, I really don't care as long as it's far apart. What I want to avoid is having configurations that belong to different states being projected on top of each other. So how do we do this in practice? Well, we start from, you probably hopefully recognize this. This is the same objective function that I had on the slides for multidimensional scaling. So what I'm trying to do here is optimize the low-dimensional points in such a way that the distances between the low-dimensional points match the distances between the high-dimensional points. So this would be multidimensional scaling. So what I do is very simple idea. I just apply a switching function to the distances so that I define a characteristic threshold where I switch from close to far. And now you see that now if I have 2 points in high dimension that end up here, and in the low dimension projection they end up here, there is no problem. After the application of the switching function, both distances are projected now to 0, and they contribute nothing to the objective function. So the idea is that I don't waste effort, I don't waste resolution trying to represent distances that I can never succeed in representing, and I focus on representing the important distances that are basically the distances just outside the range of thermal fluctuations, because these are the distances that correspond to me going from state A to state B. So how does this work in practice? Well, first let's look at how a free energy landscape looks like when you use conventional collective variables. So this is this alanine 12 polypeptide, and this is a representation of its free energy. So low values mean high probability, high value mean low probability. And this is represented, so for each state of the polypeptide, I represent it with two order parameters, which are the gyration radius, basically the end-to-end distance, and the mean square displacement relative to an ideal alpha helix. Okay? So unsurprisingly, well, the alpha helix configurations are close to zero because they are very similar to an ideal helix. And as it often happens in polypeptides, particularly because this is all alanine residues, this is very stable. And then, however, I have all of this blob, in which I have a lot of configurations that look fairly reasonable. I mean, I have a lot of hydrogen bonding in each of these states, but there is no clear fissure associated with it. If I look at this map, I would get the impression that going from here to here is barrierless. However, if I run a simulation of this system and I stay here, I can run for 100 nanoseconds before it goes away. So this is not really like this is not stable, as the free energy surface seems to suggest. This is really that these intuitive order parameters don't have the solution that is necessary to tell apart the thermal fluctuations around this structure from the thermal fluctuations around that structure. So how does this look like when you instead use, you let the simulation tell you what are the best order parameters to describe it? It looks like this. And you see now that you still have, the physics is the same. So the alpha helix is still the most stable structure by far. But now each of these reasonably looking states is associated with a local minimum in the free energy surface. And I mean, this is important for a gazillion reasons. So it's important because if you want to do accelerated sampling, as hopefully we'll see, this is a much, much better way. Because if I was using these, if you have, I don't know how much you grasped of this idea of metadynamics, of building a repulsive bias on the fly, if I'm not able to tell that this is different from that, I will not be able to push myself out of a valley into the next valley because I don't even see that there is a valley. Here, instead, it will work much, much better. And then, knowing that this is a metastable state is important for so many reasons. So first of all, in particular for these kind of systems, the force fields are very, very far from perfect. Okay? So if your simulation only tells you, oh, the alpha helix is stable, and the experiment tells you, well, hold on a second, but I think I'm seeing a bit of shit, you say, well, buddy, I see alpha helix. But if you see that the beta sheet is actually locally stable, then you can start thinking, well, hold on a second, perhaps there is something wrong with my force field. What's it that is stabilizing the alpha helix so much relative to this beta sheet, which is stable, only not as much as the, so it can give you some kind of qualitative information that is really precious when your force field is less than ideal. Also, for instance, it can tell you, hey, look, this polypeptide can also be stable like this, and the presence of some solute or some mutation can actually stabilize this. And, a lot of degenerative diseases are due to the accumulation of amyloid fibrils, and having such a clear representation that your protein, which is normal in this state, can actually also have that form, can be really useful. But let me also look back at how this is also very nicely correlated with the secondary structure. And here, just the only point I wanted to make is that I've built these maps using the dihedral angles, but there is nothing special about the dihedral. So you could use a different way to represent distances in high dimension. And you would get a picture which is different. I think that the dihedrals work better, but still you get the same qualitative picture of stable basins joined together by a network of high energy transition states. So there is one aspect that I haven't discussed yet. So this far I have told you how to run SketchMap. So this SketchMap technique builds this network of reference states. So given a couple of hundred of high dimension reference configurations for your polypeptide, tells you where those 200 configurations are. However, if you have 100 microseconds of simulation time for your polypeptide, chances are that you have more than 200 states on your hand. And so the question is, how do you find the low dimensional representation of a new point? So people have been doing something like this. So you basically take your low dimensional representation of a new high dimensional point to be a weighted sum of, so you look at how far you are from all of the reference states. You build a weight which is high when you're close to one of the reference states and low when you're far away. And you build your low dimensional representation as a weighted sum of the low dimensional representation of the reference states. So this works sort of fine, but it's a convex embedding. So it means that when you move on a line in high dimension, you will always be projected on a line in low dimension. And the problem is that if you end up in a point which is far from everything you have seen that far, let's say that these are your reference points in 3D. You have this point. Surely you would like it to be projected here relative to the representation, to the low dimensional representation of these points. But you, by construction, will actually be projected in the middle of the data set. This is because since your configuration is a weighted sum of the reference positions, you can only be within the convex hull of the low dimensional representation. So this is problematic because, again, you don't want a technique that requires you to have explored all of configuration space before it can give you something predictive, right? So you want to be able just to sample a subset of the configuration space and still be able to say something meaningful about new configurations that you might encounter. So the way we solve this problem is by doing the out-of-sample embedding, which is this procedure of finding a new point, taking very, very literally this GPS analogy that I was making before. So what we are doing now is basically we build an objective function which is very similar to the one before. The only thing is that now I have the new high-dimension configuration, big X. I look how far it is from all the references. And then I optimize the low dimension projection in such a way that I minimize the discrepancy between the distances of the new point to the high dimension references with the distances of the new projection to the low dimensional references. Okay? So basically I define the projection of a new point as the argmin of this function. And this is really nice because, as I was anticipating, it gives you a way to also, you know, they say that in ancient maps, when they couldn't explore a region, they just would put a lion there. They say, oh, there are lions there. You don't really want to go there. But it's actually useful if you want to have a predictive method to understand what are the possible configurations for your complex system. You also want to be able to know something about regions far away from what you have ever observed. So, I mean, here I have an audience which comes from all over the world, but let's say that instead one of us has been a little bit lazy and has only gone around visiting Europe and has made a nice map of Europe, but doesn't really have any idea about Greenland, Africa, or India. And then if this person has a GPS that now can only work in Europe, that's pretty boring. So the question is, can we say something now? I mean, can we tell something about where we are, even if we are far away from Europe? And we can, because you see, we can, if we are in Greenland, we can still say that we are closer to Sweden and to London than to Sicily. Huh? And if we are in Africa, we can say that we are closer to Spain and to Italy than to Sweden. So we can actually find somehow an indication of where we should be on the low-dimensional map, even if we are adventuring out of the known region. And for instance, we applied these ideas to the representation of a cluster of Lennard-Jones atoms. And this actually, you would have, if you try the hands-on, the tutorial, you would actually build a map precisely for this system. And the idea here is that this is a Lennard-Jones 38, which is used like crazy because it's a model of a solid-solid phase transition, because it can exist. It has a very low enthalpy state, which is a truncated octahedron. And then it has another state which is a bit higher in enthalpy, but is entropically stabilized, which is basically a part of an icosahedron. And then you have melting, and this becomes something very disordered. So this is basically the free energy map built using this sketch map technique. And the point is that it works across the phase diagram. So even though you have multiple transitions and multiple different states, you just build a map at any of the temperatures, and this can be descriptive also for states that are at temperatures very far from there. So here I'm basically showing you the free energy of the system as a function of temperature, okay? So at low temperature, this is clearly the most stable state. When you go up in temperature, these states become entropically stabilized, and then you basically reach melting, and everything gets into the molten. And the point is that all of these free energies have been obtained using, as a reference, the same set of structures which was taken from just one of the temperatures, okay? Also, an interesting thing is that these states are very, very well known and discussed like crazy in the literature, but what you see here, which is quite interesting, is that this system also has sort of a liquid-liquid phase transition. So there are two very different regions in the disordered state, and this is something that, I mean, we didn't tell anything to SketchMap about. It just came out very naturally. So you can actually do something really crazy. You know, I think this is the most compelling proof of how predictive a SketchMap can be, because you can say, okay, I mean, if I change the temperature in a certain sense, fluctuations, it's a small system, so fluctuation at an intermediate temperature will give me configuration from the solid to the molten state. But you can actually use the map. So here I'm taking the map that I built based on this small gas phase cluster, and I'm using it to project the structures for a bulk of the same system. So even if I'm using as a reference something that has been trained on a system which is basically 100% surface, I still have enough. Well, first of all the solid configurations are projected very far away, which is as it should be. And if we had used that weighted sum approach, we would end up pretty much in the center of the map, which is clearly nonsense. Here I'm projected far away from the map because it's a different part of configuration space. And there is an amazing resolving power, so we can distinguish structures that are from a liquid, structures that are from a solid, and you can even identify a vacancy, an interstitial, a Frankel pair, even a partial dislocation. So even though I am using as the reference a map that has been trained on a cluster, I can also say something about the condensed phase. So To summarize, and to leave a little bit of time for questions, if if you move beyond a Hubbard model and you start working with something which you have continuous variables and thermal fluctuations and multiple metastable states, it becomes a problem not only to run an accurate simulation, but also to convey intuitive information about what you are seeing in that simulation. And this is not a problem to underestimate, also because this is a problem which will only get worse as more complex systems become amenable to modeling. So I think that it's really crucial that at this time we also start thinking about how we can use the computer not only to run the simulation but also to help us understand it. And I think that from this point of view we have a lot to learn from computer science and the machine learning community, who have done these kind of things in completely different contexts for quite a long time now. At the same time, it's important that we recognize that the systems we are working on are different from the, I don't know, from recognizing your face when you are at the airport. And so we have to somehow encode into our algorithm this physical understanding at the very bottom of the, I mean, at the very beginning of the design phase. So I have presented you sort of an overview of the techniques that you have available for doing these things, so mostly clustering and nonlinear dimensionality reduction. And if you are interested, so this is a very lengthy book about multidimensional scaling. Actually, interestingly, multidimensional scaling was first invented, to give you an idea of, I mean, of the context in which these techniques arise. So the first application of multidimensional scaling was for sort of market analysis. So they were asking people whether they liked the product or not, while changing different features of the product. And then they wanted to understand how, I mean, how to make sense of the response of the people when they had a multivariated parameter space for the response of the people to the change of these different features of the product. So this is really a very general idea, and I think it can be applied very fruitfully to simulations. Then you can have a look at some of the standard techniques. And you can download some code. There are tutorials and other stuff. You can just look up this website. And with this, I'm done. So thank you for your attention.